So I'm very glad that I have the opportunity to talk to you today. And I thought, given that we have such a great project, the Gold Project, and so many experts and specialists coming here, I thought I'd offer you some provocations, some things that I looked into in my recent research. So I hope that you find this interesting and that it gives you a lot of food for thought when I talk about democracy's twilight, artificial intelligence, openness and design, and the structure of my talk basically will be five steps with three provocations in the middle. So back to the future, short introduction, then I'm going to talk about the openness of AI. I'm going to make one argument about accountability and the law, about action, and then I'll summarize. So back to the future, what do I mean by that? Just to give you some of my basic assumptions from one thread of the reflection of technologies I'm really interested in, which is science and technology studies. And this understanding and this approach that innovation and development of technology is contingent. So while it has normative force, while it really impacts us, it's there is many a lot of room for choice. And actually, by engaging with technology, we are shaping these developments. So it's not only the technology shaping us, but also we shape this technology. I refer to the exchange of Sandra Wachte and Joanna, which I think made this point very clear. And together with that, processes of transformation do not follow a automated logic, but they're open. And my movie reference here is Back to the Future, and not because of the movie itself, but the way it handled technology and also the way it implanted the ideas of certain technologies into us. It's really interesting, a film from 1985 projecting the future in 2015. So when you watch it, you really have a sense of how they in a way painted a futurist picture almost of today or of seven years ago. And I find this very interesting. For example, the hoverboards. Yeah, a lot of startups try to build them just because they saw them there. But there is also a lot of influence on the design, for example, of flat screens, which were painted there, but didn't exist at the time. Even the technologies didn't really exist at the time. So back to the future, we are continuously shaping technology, and this has a big impact on democracy. And in a way, it's interesting to think about this from a collective and individual self-determination point of view. And you will see what I mean by that, especially when I talk about openness. So my first point, and this is a really important point to me, it's so great to see that artificial intelligence as a field of research is quite open. The term AI is not limited to machine learning, but you could frame it as a much bigger research question in computer sciences. It's not one technology, but a set of technologies, and it's open regarding the technologies and resources and the purposes. There is even further aspects of the openness. Let me provide you with a proof of what I present you today in the chat. So if you want to look it up, the main arguments, you'll find it in the chat. But let's look a little bit at openness. So technologies and resources, it's really important for us to think of AI in a continuum that started with general ideas like good old-fashioned AI that should be based on common sense, to the expert systems in the 90s that were based on expert knowledge, and now artificial neural networks, deep learning that is very data intensive based on data. But it's also good to have the hypothesis that this will not be the end of the development of AI, and several approaches are on the horizon, like evolutionary AI. And for evolutionary AI, personal data might be much less relevant, so it could rely much more on computation. So the technologies and the resources we use for AI are open in the sense that there is a lot of choice. And I argue, and I think Sandra has proven this point already, as a general purpose technology, we can use AI for very different purposes. Yeah, the purposes are open. I can use it for discrimination. I can, if I train on biased data sets and employ these algorithms, but I can also use it to visualize, to make known, or to a certain extent to remedy discriminations, especially in the architectures Joanna described. And the same is true for other values as well. So take, for example, privacy. I'll not go into detail, but the social credit system has shown which big threats come from AI for privacy. And there is many more examples, but this has been a very, very obvious one. But on the other hand, it's really interesting to see how AI also works as privacy enhancing technology. And I was, in the preparation of this talk, really astonished that you find a lot of tools actually in the app stores of your mobile phone that help you to enforce privacy, like this anonymization tool. There's a lot of anonymization tools, photo anonymization, different things to enforce privacy. And the general point behind this is that this gives us the sense that we can use this technology for many different purposes. It's actually open. So in building certain technologies, of course, we have, for example, to use personal data, but even that could potentially be remedied if I use other architectures. So to appreciate the openness, I try to think about what could this mean for the law. I like that we came to this regulatory discussion. And what struck me is that in law and ethics, we often try to in a way translate principles. So we have this principle in ethics and law and as a social norm, and then we try to specify it so that engineers can understand it. And what I propose to you now is to appreciate the openness in a different way by creating a meso principle. So reinforcing this openness normatively by creating a meso principle. That in a way allows for systems to be adapted in different ways. And here I want to be sensitive to the very different and context dependent problems that AI can actually have, and want to reinforce the fact that we also have to see these systems in the whole life cycle. So it's not enough to just have compliance at the start, but really to see how they pan out throughout their life cycle. So this is my first provocation, or my first idea that I would like to discuss for you. Could there be a principle of designability? So not taking something that is already existing in law, but trying to create something between law, ethics, technology that actually translates several values at the same time. So it's a meso principle. It's enforcing democracy and self-determination. And my idea is that it has two limbs. The first is that it has to the choices have to be intelligible. So actually, I have to know about the design choices, and I have to know about their effects. And I can describe this like patterns. So if I go this way, then this will happen. And if I go that way, then that will happen. Yeah. So it has to be intelligible to a certain extent. And the other point that is really important to me, changeable. Yeah. It's not either or, but we might have a variety of choices, either in the system itself or in other systems that could be in a way trained as an alternative. And this would be realizing this principle of designability to a full extent. So one discourse I find very interesting, and that ties into the first presentation as well, are these school placement algorithms. And it's really interesting that there have been several cases, some of which could be actually remedied. So some could be fixed, some actually provided for ways which Joanna mentioned. So an ex post rule-based correction to factor certain things differently in, for example, allocating students or drawing up school districts. And there is also design alternatives. So people thinking, I want to have a different system, and I actually provide the alternative. And I think that's a great, great area to study designability and to study the way in which we can keep our choices open while using AI and to reinforce this great openness of AI normatively. So that's my first provocation. Second provocation, accountability. And I'm very thankful for the words of the president of the University of Münster highlighting the problem that accountability is a big question. It stems for me from the openness, but also from the increasing autonomy of these systems, that they can handle problems more independently. So how do we account for that? And again, I'm tying into the discussion before, we could try to make systems more responsible, even to elevate them in their legal status. I've provided you here with AI systems that want to embody people. I know that many people in the audience are critical of that, including myself, but also the idea of an e-personality. And as was mentioned before, I want to go exactly in the other direction. So I think we need to do exactly the opposite. And this means to look at what humans are doing. And for that, I'm using a theory of science and technology studies, actor network theory, because actor network theory very early on stressed the agency of technology. It says, well, we have to appreciate artifacts as actors and their collaboration with humans. So they're not only tools in the sense of Karl Jaspers, but they have their own agency. So a person holding a gun is something different than a person without a gun. Yeah. They stress the agency. And one could think that this whole discourse about AI in a way is actor network theory brought to life. But I say no, the interesting thing about actor network theory is that it highlighted hidden agency. It highlighted hidden agency when technology was embedded in society. And I think exactly that's what we have to do. And we have to highlight the agency of human beings. Yeah, it was mentioned before, how do these processes of training work? How is the organization structured? So to know about these things. So I look at the reverse A&T constellations and I say humans are still actors in this. And we have to take an ex ante perspective. That's also my take on the regulation. Take this ex ante perspective and try to impact that. So how do we do this? Not by crying out loud that there is an algocracy coming, but to look more closely on what happens. And one way for me to translate this into the legal discussion would be, for example, to reinterpret a very important rule about automated decision making, which is Article 22 GDPR. So I published this recently in the Heidelberg Journal of International Law. And I said, before we, there were many good discussions, very helpful discussions about how to interpret this this rule, but they were always focusing on specific rights as if this was a tick box approach that I have to look into transparency or a right to humane decision or things like that. And I said, look at the parallel structure of 22 and Article 25 and appreciate the fact that we can actually use this as a human rights by design norm. As a human rights by design norm that forces us to engage with human rights impacts and make human rights compliance part of the development process. As Article 25 through an indirect way, but make it part of the development process. And if you think about Article 22 like that, it completely changes the way it's applied, because you have to engage in design choices. You have to look into the design, and the responsibility of human actors arises, because then it's not the machines, but it's the human people choosing the training data and so on and so forth, making the design choices. Yeah. So this could be a way to also reconceptualize what we already have in order to make impacts on the design and strengthen the accountability that is hidden. And that's human accountability for me. So that's my second provocation, my second thought. reinterpret Article 22, strengthen accountability. And now my third provocation, let's see at the time. No, I'm really good. I have time to explain this in depth. So the question is, what does it mean to engage in technology design? And I want to make three arguments here. So for an increased proactiveness, building on Sandra Wachter's presentation, but maybe adding a little bit to that even. So going a little bit beyond that, to appreciate the social technical design and to take active approaches. So you will hopefully glean in a minute what I mean by that. But let me start with proactiveness. And you can really see in the way that societal concerns have been flagged for technology development has evolved substantially since the 70s. So in the 70s, it was all about technology impact assessments. What are the impacts? We have to criticize it, has to be remedied. Yeah. But there was a very interesting strand of the technology and society literature calling for responsible research and innovation. So to influence these processes at a very early age to really guide technology development, and this included also some ideas that I framed as the third idea, which is mission-driven technology development. And this means that we proactively look for the realization of values through systems. So really try to build them into the design and to innovate for social, ethical, and legal values. So my provocative statement, of course, also because Katharina Zweig is the next speaker, is shall we go from algorithm watch to make good AI? Of course, Katharina is a computer scientist as well, so I trust that she makes good AI. But this would be my question, whether we should also as scholars think about more proactive stances on the field from a democratic perspective as well. And one thing that I think is key in that debate is one additional argument, which is that the social technical design is part of AI design. So here I pick out, maybe that's not entirely fair, but I pick out one argument from the German Data Ethics Commission, in a way, one categorization of algorithms. And while I think it's not wrong, it gives rise to a misunderstanding that in a way there are different concepts of algorithms. But what I want to show you now is that actually it's the social embedding and the law that plays a huge role whether the algorithms are whether a system is algorithm-based, algorithm-driven, or algorithm-determined. So it can be completely the same system that falls under all the same categories. And here I draw on a very interesting case. Very interesting, not because something went wrong, but because the Australian Parliament and an ombudsman did the work to actually look into what went wrong. Yeah, that's the Centrelink case, the Australian online intervention system to reclaim debts. And the interesting thing is that what the Australian authorities do is with minor adaptations, take a recommender system that would work with civil servants, that was meant to be used by civil servants, and put it in a situation in which there was a full automation of reclaiming social benefits. And I think it's really interesting to see that here the almost the same system has been used in a different context. So it's not the AI that has changed, but it's the Australian authorities issuing a law and providing for a process of using AI differently. Yeah. So you cannot say that it's an algorithm based, driven or determined system itself, but the use is different. Yeah. And if we understand that, that opens up a whole new a level of opportunities to design AI and to design AI also from a social technical sense and to impact on different levels of AI. And here now comes my argument. So how could we go further? And this is really a speculative question, but I'd be very interested in your remarks. So when we say AI can be good or bad, and it's certainly not neutral, what does this mean for democracy? We know a lot about negative uses of AI concerning democracy. There is this concept of mad comms that influence voter behavior in an illicit way. But could there also be ways of, in a way, translating democratic ideas or translating democratic ideas and sentiments to a higher level? And here my provocation is that maybe with the right use case, artificial intelligence in some settings could work as a kind of customary law. Yeah? Customary law is a concept that has been used a lot in the past, but today it's only used in international law, commercial and public. And in other areas, it fell out of use because of course, the number of actors grew and law got more complex. So it was much more difficult to in a way, structure all these interactions. But my question would be, if we had a certain custom, a certain thing, could we in a way regard this also as a democratic expression, because in a way all the data goes into one system. And I think it's interesting that the criteria of customary law highlight interesting problems. So there needs to be, of course, a link between the data and the rules. So the in a way, the behavior has to be expressive of something that also backs a decision. The question is, how do we in a way care for the practice, or how do we construct the practice? What's the level we need here to say there is a common practice between several people, and the system can also give this back? How do we deal with objections? There's a lot of literature and international law on that. And the most interesting thing is, what level of awareness do the data subjects, the people producing the data, need to have? That's a key question in customary law. Is it just a practice, or is it a practice that is really a voluntary, an intentional decision with the idea that this also is done in a way to follow a legal obligation? So I think while I don't have the concrete use case, I think it's very interesting to think about this as a specific problem to in a way have not explicit votes. There's a lot of literature on that, but to have implicit actions making up a custom that could gain normative force and be in a way a crowdsourced custom. With that, I would like to come to my concluding remarks. And here, my hope is that we reverse the stories. Because, of course, if you followed reflections on the internet early on, the internet was hailed as the new technology for democracy that enables completely new models and helps us to come to another level of democracy. And you have also, most of you will also have witnessed in the last decade, the middle of the last decade, that this completely flipped around. So with the Snowden revelations and many other revelations, we had to concede that you can think very differently of that as surveillance capitalism and so on and so forth. So the internet went from hero to zero. And my hope is that AI might turn out to be from zero to hero, because at the moment it's conceptualized as a kind of killer of democracy and taking over human agency. But maybe we can see these potentials for augmentation, and maybe we can actually make use of the big openness AI provides, with partly also with creative approaches, but also on the accountability side, focusing on the design and engaging deeply with technology. So can we reverse the stories? I showed you what I have done or I'm thinking about doing in that regard, just to remind you. So first, openness and this legal principle of designability as a meso principle between law and technology, but also between different legal values that could serve different legal values and keep options open and remind us of that in the design process. Accountability of reframing certain obligations as these law by design, human rights by design obligations, and therefore impacting design processes by making humans accountable. And the third one, to think about how we can actually use AI for democratic practices. And I gave you the example of customary law as a democratic mediation, so as a mediation between the practice of people and specific decisions. I think there is much more. There's also much more direct ways to see, to impact democracy. To give you just one example, because I think I still have a minute left. So in my group, what we did is to build a translation machine that simplifies language for people, because we have crowd-based workshops on mission-driven innovations where we talk to different stakeholders and enable them to, in a way, form their ideas and form ideas about what they want to use AI for. And a lot of people came to us and said, especially from public administration, actually, I have this problem. I want to use this concept of simplified language more often, but we don't have the resources in our organization to have everything translated. So we engaged in a very interesting process that didn't fix the problem with one AI system, but that deeply engaged in the whole question. We built did several things in this space, but just to show you that even a lawyer can make an impact. So I'm sure the other disciplines can as well. And I'd be very happy to talk to you if you feel like if you're already engaging or feel like engaging in more proactive manners in this space. But also if you're critical of that, do not hesitate to reach out to me by email or the social network of your choosing. I'm not part of every social network, but the ones of your choosing. And with that, I thank you very much for your attention.